Hello and welcome to a new webinar. We are trying today to talk a bit about something that may interest all of us in some way or another, whether we are discretionary traders or algorithmic traders. We may be interested in trying to get the market pulse and gather enough information to understand what phase a market is in. Before getting to business, I wish to welcome all of you that are attending. And if everything is technically as it should be, you should be hearing me. And even seeing me, if you didn't see me before. My name is Julian. I'm located in Romania. I'm with Forex Boat, and today I will be your host of this webinar. Please, in the chat room, in the GoToWebinar application, you may address all and every question you feel you might have. I will try to answer them as they come. And to verify that technically we are good to go, please, if you want to share, I would like to know from you, where are you from, the countries of origin, if you please. Let's see how international our audience is. If you are too shy to share that type of information, you may type a yes or a one to see that you are hearing me and seeing me and everything is all right and good to go. So please. Hello, Charles, Christian, Kuvesi. Kypriakos. By the looks of it, we are spread all around the world. And I guess 4 or 5 minutes is long enough for anyone to get in the room, and we may start. Before doing that, I remind you that any and all information provided in this webinar is not to be construed as investment or financial personal advice. For that, there are more qualified entities to advise you. And this is for educational and informational purposes only. This is basically what this disclaimer is telling you. Please take a minute to go through all of it. E-market regimes detection. What does it mean? The markets in general, and financial markets in particular, because we are interested in trading in financial markets, go through different phases during their active trading hours. And whether we are discretionary traders or algorithmic traders, it is important for us to understand which of those phases the market we are trying to trade is in at any specific moment. And maybe having that information or enough information about that aspect of that market, we may try to adapt to the current market condition and take advantage of the opportunity that arises. If we were to classify, let's say, the market states that we may meet during our trading activities, we may classify them in different ways, different criterias. If we use, for example, the directionality, that is an aspect of a financial market, we may classify a market and qualify it as being bullish or bearish. If we choose to look at how fast the price is changing in relation to the recent price change in the past, we may tell about a market that is volatile or calm. If we have sudden changes and rather large movements in market in a very short time, a market is qualified as being volatile. If changes are not that ample, the movements are not that extensive, we may tell about that market that is calm. Also, another important feature of market can be qualified as a characteristic that tells us something about a specific market. Can be that if that market is trending, for example, or congesting, which isn't in any way the same thing as bullish or bearish and volatile and calm and trending and congesting. As we can see, these are only three, and there are more criterias we can qualify a market, and we may try to classify how a market behaves. But for starters, we will try to talk about these three that are most obvious to new and experienced traders, and we can try to understand how we could recognize a bullish or bearish market, a volatile or calm market, a trending or congesting market, and use that to our advantage. And for that, I propose you to look at some examples, and then maybe we could move to some charts or real life market data. In this image, what we can see that a bullish market is characterized by mostly an up moving market, a market that moves mostly in the upward direction. A bearish market, conversely, can be a market that moves mostly in the downward direction. And to qualify a market as bullish or bearish, we can employ the use of many indicators, which from which maybe the most common and widely used one is a moving average that may have a certain length, looking back at a number of periods. But that is something we will talk about a bit later. So if a bullish market looks like the one in the picture above, and the bearish market looks like a picture, like one in a picture below, we see that even a bullish market has a beginning and an end. And what we may see as a relatively horizontal price evolution, either at the beginning or at the end of a bullish or a bearish market, that later we will see that is usually a state of the market any market goes through also known as consolidation. What we are interested in a bullish market, we are interested not in the head of the fish, not in the tail of the fish, we are interested to it from the mid of the fish, from the body, from the middle. We are trying to catch the biggest move and if possible, as soon as possible, and get out of that market once we have enough reasons to believe that the move that made that market be considered bullish or bearish is about to end. How we'll do that? Again, a little bit later. Now, speaking about volatile and calm markets, again, what a volatile and a calm market look like? Just by looking at the candle sizes, for example, we can determine that a market is volatile or calm. And if we see something different on this chart than the chart before is, we don't really need a moving average for this purpose. And we have on our chart another indicator that can tell us something about the volatility in a market, if the market is volatile or calm. That indicator for this exemplification purpose is the ATR, average true range. And another thing present on our charts are the markings of the beginning of the day. In the above chart, we see two vertical dotted lines. That is the one in the left is the starting of the day. The one at the right is the end of a day. And in between the start and the end of the day, we have a whole trading day because this is a chart on M15. So every candle is 15 minutes long. A calm market, conversely, we see can happen after the New York session closes and the Asian session didn't begin, and even during the Asian session when the end of the day and the beginning of a new day is right here. For example, we see the candle sizes are smaller and the market tends to move in a horizontal pattern, like we can see here also. So we have volatile markets during the trading period of the day, and usually at the end of the day and the beginning of a new day, we have calm markets. What about the average true range indicator? The average true range indicator, in this case, I believe it's a 10 periods ATR on the chart. We see that the line drawn in blue on chart is going through a series of values, and those values practically represent the average size of the last 10 candles at any moment in time. For example, we see that at this point the ATR reaches a maximum. Why? Because on average for the last 10 candles back, this was the moment when the maximum value was reached, and from then on the value of the ATR dropped as a result of the fact that the candles progressively became smaller and smaller. So whether we are just looking at the charts and we try to gauge the volatility by the dimension of the candles, or we use an indicator like ATR, we can in this manner assess whether the market we are trading is volatile or calm. Another aspect of the market may be useful to us to understand as soon as possible before it begins, so as soon as it began to be a trending market, and eventually assess and understand when the market became a congested one. What the trending market does for us as traders offers more opportunity to enter in positions where the movement is ample. The amplitude of the movement hides energy, and that energy comes in form of pips, which for us means money in the trading account. Again, we see beginning of the day, end of the day, the two lines, vertical dotted lines on the upper chart, and on the lower chart, one vertical line, and we can also observe that the pattern repeats itself. So during the active hours of most markets, we have markets that move, and during the least active hours of the day, we usually have markets that move less. And that is something to take into consideration, whether we are trying to trade those markets or we are trying to write code that may exploit this pattern or behavior. As indicators, as far as indicators are concerned, trending and congesting can be assessed, gauged, and determined subjectively, never objectively, because we have access to trading tools that introduces lag in the analysis, because they are based on math calculations on past prices. So every indicator we will ever use will be a laggy one. In this case also, we choose an indicator in an attempt to gauge the trending or the congesting characteristics of a market, and that is, as you can see, Bollinger Bands. For those who are not that familiar with this indicator, it is constructed around the moving average, that is the center line of the indicator, and two other lines, an upper band and a lower band, which are displaced at a distance according to statistically determined value about the volatility in that market. So two standard deviation is the standard setting of the indicator, and if the price reaches the upper band or the lower band, we call that market a market that tries to expand its range. And as we can see, periods of expanding the range alternate with periods where the range is contracting. If we are looking at the Bollinger Bands, the bands become increasingly wider, then narrower, then wider again, then narrower, then wider again. A trending market is usually the market that causes the Bollinger Bands to expand. So that is something to look at if we are trying to gauge this characteristic of the market. We are looking for a trending market. A market that is trending is usually one in which the price is above a moving average or is causing an indicator like Bollinger Bands, for example, to expand its range, the distance in between the upper band and the lower band. And that being said, let's say that the three main ways of characterizing a market we've talked about are pretty much set up. and we can move on trying to understand what can we do with the information we've just gathered. So we know something about the market and we have an idea about what phase the market is. What's that good for? How can that help us? If we choose to listen to what market has to tell us, we may choose to size up trades based on new information we have. We may choose to switch the entry rules we use that are more fitted to the current market condition. We may choose to pick the right strategy, exit strategy, and our exit points based on the new information we have. Sizing up trades is something we need to master if we want to employ proper risk management, and we choose to not ignore what others already established scientifically before us. We may choose to experiment around and build upon what they already constructed and theorized. If proper money management is employed, we, as far as we can understand and apply money management techniques, more or less risky, we know that trading is rather a statistical proposal. It's more probabilistic than predictive. And from that perspective, if we are to look at how market behaves generally, we can observe, we can see that usually volatility in a market is something that on one hand we may try to take advantage of, but on the other hand it comes with a price, and that price is the fact that the market behaves unpredictably. So let's try to think at this choice we have, and one by one maybe understand why sizing trades is a bit counterintuitive for many. When a volatility event, like a news event, for example, or just the simple fact that the market just opened, that introduces volatility in the market because more market participants jump in and each one has its own idea, plan, and so on and so forth. And practically it's a battle, it's a tug of war. Everybody pushes and pulls, and that volatility makes the market unpredictable. What do we do then? How do we size our trades when the market is less predictable? We can see that is more volatile, but is it more predictable? When a market is in a congestion phase, isn't that a little bit more predictable than a volatile market? Because everybody can jump on that bandwagon, on those bullish candles in the first case, and find themselves up there buying the top. Why? Because we don't know how much it will go up. If we get in too late, we remain hanging up there. On the other hand, in a congestive market, in a congested market, we may find ourselves in something that looks like the image below. And in there, we may have different patterns we could trade, like channels or wedges or triangles or other type of patterns that with limited risk allow many traders to take advantage of what is most likely to happen next. Because trading in general is not about what will happen next, is not about what I think will happen next, is not about, I don't know what TV station tells me has to happen next. Trading in general is about what is more likely to happen next. And when we see the first picture, if we disregard the bearish candles, we may wish to think that move will continue. But at one point, that move doesn't continue anymore. Why? Because at a certain point, it was more likely that the move reverses. On the other hand, when the market is not very volatile, we have more time to react. We already see that it respects more or less some levels, and we may try to sell the top and buy the bottom. So increasing or decreasing the lot size to match the predictability of the market is a proposition, is a choice we have to make for ourselves. And if we choose to take more risk when the market is more unpredictable, that's also a choice. Or we may want to take less risk or when the market is less predictable. In a trending market, we may wish to take a look or seek some confluence. Confluence as a term in trading means that there are times when on our charts, more than one indicators are trying to tell us the same thing about the respective market. And for example, if we are trying to trade a trending market and we are using as one of the rules of the entry rules a moving average, like we can see in the above picture, then we may want to look or seek more confirmation for every entry, and that we can make, for example, if trending is what we seek and trends is what we want to capture, we may want to look at something that is telling us more about the momentum in the market. And maybe there isn't any more appropriate indicator than the momentum indicator, that is gauging the momentum in the market, or the RSI, that is widely used and known. And based on what thresholds we set, whether we are only trading the moving average or we are trying to get more confirmation from the momentum indicator or from the RSI, we can see that there are points on this chart, at least, where one indicator is telling us something and the others are not agreeing yet or at all. For example, we see that a spike in price somewhere at the near the beginning of the day corresponds somewhat to a coming from the overbought area of the RSI, but the momentum indicator doesn't agree with that. Maybe just because the RSI is a very short term, in this case a 14 period. Maybe the moving average is looking at 50 periods back, and maybe the momentum is looking also at the 50 periods back. We see that the momentum indicator, at least, because it is an unbounded indicator, so it has no limits like the RSI has. It only has a center axis of symmetry, that is a 100 value, and is considered to be a downward momentum when the indicator's line crosses below that 100 level. On the other hand, the RSI is a bounded indicator, and in between 0 and 100, it oscillates up and down. And the two reference levels many traders use are 30 and 70. And in this case, we are watching the 70 level, for example. And when price causes the indicator to drop below that 70 level, we say about the RSI that it came back into the tradable zone in between the 70 and the 30 on its scale. But that is not yet the moment if we are looking at the moving average, as we can see. So a trending market, how trendy the market is and how close our rules are to what happens in the market, that depends on how we design our rules and what indicators we pick and what periods we choose to put on those indicators to make them more more speedy, to introduce less lag in our analysis. And with that comes another set of inconveniences, like fake signals, for example. So an indicator, the faster it is, the shorter the period we set on it, the more it will oscillate, the closer it will follow the price or the price evolution. But with that comes the set of inconveniences, of which fake signals or false signals are maybe the most common ones. A congesting market, if we choose to use to gauge the congestive nature of the market, let's say the Bollinger Bands, we may look at how far apart are the upper and the lower band, and we may choose to confirm that state of the market, the congestive state, with an indicator like ATR, which also gauges the volatility, the recent volatility. In this case, we know that the Bollinger Bands, for example, have as default value 20 periods, and the ATR in this case is set to 10, for example. And we can see that following in between two vertical dotted lines, those in the image, we have two trading days practically. We see that periods of expanding markets, when the distance between the upper band and the lower band of the Bollinger Bands are widening, are alternating with periods of time when the Bollinger Bands move closer together and the market is congesting. Those periods, by chance or because that's a function of the market, are coinciding with a reading on the ATR indicator that either is showing as a drop in the value of the ATR because the candles become smaller and smaller, or a period of time where the indicator is drawing lines in a horizontal pattern. And this is, let's say, on the main chart we may have an indicator, and as a secondary rule or filter we may employ another one that is telling us something about maybe a different aspect of the market or about the same market and the same aspect, but looking through a different looking glass. Because if in this example we were using, let's say, 20 periods for the Bollinger Bands, we are using a faster, a smaller period for the ATR, 20 and 10, for example. Why? Because both of them are telling us something about the volatility, but we need confirmation and soon when it comes to recent volatility, and that is why the ATR was chosen to be a little faster than the Bollinger Bands. Now that, let's say, we have a rough idea about what the market phases are, how we can distinguish in between them, how we can gauge them, what indicators we may use to understand what market, if and when each market goes through which phase, and so on and so forth. If we are not interested only in entering trades, but eventually taking profit, we should also be interested in picking some exit points. And if we can manage to pick the right ones, we may end up actually profiting from all the work we've done. And this may be some or just a few of the criteria we may want to use when we trade discretionarily or when we code and try to do some algorithmic trading. These are just three questions. People that trade, the longer we trade, more questions they imagine and ask themselves and find answers to. But these three are the obvious ones, and let's see what we can do about them. So picking the exit points can be done in a number of ways. And for example, if we've used a set of rules to enter a trade, the obvious question is what happens when the entry condition is not valid anymore? Logically, if the market changed enough and the price moved around a lot and far enough, and that all that made the entry condition being not valid anymore, maybe it's a good point to exit that trade. Another question, equally obvious, if not more obvious, is did the market change phase? Because we may trade, for example, a trending system. And we know from backtesting, for example, or from previous experience, that a trending system tends to work better when the market is trending, obviously. So what happens when the market is not trending anymore? Isn't that a good point to exit? Because after a market stops trending, it may rest or reverse. Do we know what will happen next? No. Will we ever know? No. Even the talking heads on the TV stations are always telling us information we already might have about things that already happened. So as soon as we have fresh information about the market that just changed in front of our eyes, If we have new information, we act on that information. And if the market changed phase, maybe that's an exit point. Why? Just because I paid to get in, I got where I am now on the chart, and when the market changed phase, because I don't know where it will go from this point, maybe it's a good point to exit. Were we proven wrong? Because wherever and whenever we choose to take a position, whether it is long or short or not at all, because even not being in a trade can be a position. So no matter the position we are in, we always base our actions on assumptions. We have a working hypothesis, and when that what we suppose will happen, what we think will happen, doesn't happen, we are practically proven wrong. And whether we are already in a position or in no position at all, seeing or having certain information about the fact that our supposition was proven wrong may be enough reason to set then and there an exit point. What happens if we are trying to take a tool from our toolbox and do something with it that it wasn't designed to do? Sure, we may try to brush our teeth with a hammer in the morning, but that doesn't work that well, that if we were to use a toothbrush, right? That is practically in the same way in trading, because a momentum-based system can take advantage and tends to function better where and when we are using trading tools that are telling us and are gathering for us information about what a trending market looks like, how big the momentum in the market is, and what other aspect is interesting for us as momentum traders, then we have better chances at getting profitable. If we are, on the other hand, using a mean reversion system, we are looking for a different way of markets. We are using another set of tools. And as soon as we get a sniff that the market changed and it isn't a sideways moving market, a ranging market, a predictable market anymore, we sit on our hands because it's better. Individual moving averages, moving average crossovers, oscillators, these are just three of many things we can use in momentum systems, in trading systems that are trying to trade momentum-based markets. From physics, if we remember enough, momentum is that characteristic of an object or a phenomenon, in this case, the price behavior and evolution, in which we may count, so in some sort of way, our working theory is that the price, the market itself, has a certain inertia. So if a moving market moves in one direction, it tends to stay in that direction as long as there is enough energy in the market. And momentum systems, trending systems in general, are practically trying to take advantage of this characteristic, because in like with many other social activities, trading is in some way a social activity too. We all know, and maybe we've experienced firsthand, that itch we have to buy the green candle just because it's green and we see it rising. But in many cases, that may prove to be the wrong way to do, because you are not going to the store to buy apples when they are already expensive. You are looking for sales. You are looking for discounts. And trend trading systems can be profitable even if they buy tops. FOMO or FOMO or fear of missing out can be profitable, but you need the right market to do that. A market that tends to move up and down, and more often than not to reverse on you, is not a very good momentum system trading market. So that is why we may choose to use a number of indicators, the confluence we talked about earlier, to gauge whether we are indeed in a market that we may want to trade. For example, on the chart we see a couple of moving averages and an oscillator, and whether we use one single moving average or a combination of more than one, and another confirmation, in this case an RSI. If we trade above a moving average as bullish and we wait for the RSI to get in the tradable zone, for example, coming from an oversold area into the tradable zone, then maybe we would be in this kind of move as soon as the price moved above the moving average, or as soon as the RSI confirmed that is moving more upward than downward, or when the two moving average we chose crossed each other and practically confirmed that the price moved so far so fast that they didn't have time to catch the price yet. And we see that extensive moves like this one can be traded in at least three different ways using practically just two indicators. And we can imagine even more combinations possible. Mean reversion systems, on the other hand, have as a working theory the theory that says that a market that where the underlying asset becomes too expensive tends to discount the price, and when the price becomes too cheap tends to make the price go up again. And mean reversion systems work better in markets that move in a more predictable manner, maybe in a sideways pattern, maybe in low volatility conditions, maybe at certain hours of the day, maybe in certain markets, maybe in assets that are highly correlated and tend to move together hand in hand, up and down. And no matter what happens in the rest of the world, these two may be happy, just the two of them. In this case, we see on the chart the Bollinger Bands, we've talked earlier, and the ATR, both of them telling us something about the volatility. And as we see that, because the Bollinger Bands is a statistically proven math-based indicator that is telling us that for the vast majority of the time, that depends on the parameters of the indicator itself, but the default settings, for example, when we use the Bollinger Bands spaced two standard deviations apart, this standard distance is statistically proven that contains the price for more than 90% of the time, which is a very valuable information to have if we intend to exploit it. And when we determine that the volatility is low, for example, looking at the ATR, we may wait for the right moment for the price to move out of the Bollinger Band and sell that price, no matter the color of the candle. If the volatility isn't increasing, so we are not in a trending market, but maybe in a congestive market, or the market that is congesting as we are looking at it. So if the Bollinger Bands have already begun to shrink, to narrow the distance in between them, maybe we are witnessing practically a market that is going towards a congestion phase. And every excursion of the price outside the Bollinger Bands in a market that tends to congest is a good opportunity to get in that move, aiming for the center line, for example. And the mean reversion system is practically doing that while being very careful at whether the signs are there, because mean reversion systems tend to work better in sideways moving markets, in ranging markets, in congested markets. The right balance, now we aim to attain is that in between reactivity and stability. And by that, I mean indicators we use, we choose what parameters to use them with. And if we choose longer periods, the indicators tend to be less responsive to what happens in the market, simply because the calculations they make and the information they plot on the chart is telling us something about a longer period looking back. But on the other hand, if we make the period too short, their responsiveness increases, their lag decreases, but we may end up in trades based on fake signals or on signals that are not strong enough, or that are proven to be not strong enough. Because indicators in general are not wrong. There isn't any problem in all indicators are right. Why? Because the indicators are nothing else but a trading tool that is doing some math and is showing a result. So they either work or they don't work. The fact that they help us attain our goal depends more on us than on them, because we choose the indicator we want to use, we choose the parameters. All we have to do is choose wisely and match the right tool with the right job. So for that, we have to take into consideration what the indicator does, what it was designed to do, what was the recommended setting for it, how it is used by other traders, because we may trade in our little office in front of our little screen, but if we see on our screen we and 10 other traders in the whole world, us 11 people are seeing this chart and none of the others see the same thing, we trade against something we don't even know exists. But if we on our charts we are using the time frame most people use, we are using the indicators most people use, we may end up in trades that most people end up in. And trading with them or against them is again a choice in the end. But coming back to the indicators and how we may want to use them in our trading systems, we will always have to pay attention and find this precarious balance, reactivity, stability. We want our indicators to be more reactive, or we want our results or our signals to be more stable. We want to rely more or less on the speed of the news that are coming in, because everything that happens anywhere in the world influences the price moves, and then the indicator is showing us how much time has passed since new information came in. Do we want to act on first information? Do we want to act on information that comes sooner or later? Do we want to act on every new information we have? And so on and so forth. So we not only have to mitigate the noise and the lag that comes with every indicator just by modifying the period, we want also to pick the right indicators, the right tools for every job we have, and we may want to look into adjusting sometimes the indicators to show us faster the things we want to see faster, or to show us reliable information when reliability, stability we seek. And in an attempt to, let's say, illustrate that last point, let's look at this chart and observe what happens here. By some traders' taste, this is a very busy chart, and it is so just because I intended to make it look and show more information than it should show at any one moment. We were talking about mitigating the noise and how we can do that by adjusting the period and choosing the right indicator. If in a simple enough example, as an entry rule, we use a moving average, and as a confirmation rule, we choose to use an RSI, for example, just by modifying the period of the moving average and the period of the RSI, we see that we may have different entries and different exit points even, just by looking at different signals of entry and confirmation. For example, the longer period moving average, that is the thickest one on the chart, tends to put us in trades later, but also tends to keep us in trades longer. Conversely, the shortest period moving average, which is the thinnest of them three on the chart, puts us in trades immediately. Sometimes it gets us out of trades because price touches that moving average more times than the others that have different periods, longer periods, and even can make us get in trades that have no perspective, let's say, because at one point the price not only moved and crossed the moving average, but candles closed on the other side of the moving average, and that may be a sign or a signal to enter long, for example. If we choose to use as an entry rule more than one moving average, then the combination of the moving averages we use may put us in trades, and this is a combo pack, may put us in trades sooner and may keep us in trades longer. Under which conditions? If the exit rule is not the same as the entry rule, for example, let's say we enter on one moving average and we exit on another. Let's say we enter when we have all the ducks in a row and we have the main entry rule and the confirmation rule satisfied, and we exit as soon as something scares us. And for that, let's say we enter on the longer period moving average and we exit on the shorter period moving average. And that is a perfectly valid way of scalping, for example. Now, if we put and we introduce into this picture the RSI also, that may complicate it. In this case, we have superimposed one on top of the other, three RSIs with three different periods. And if I see it right, we have an RSI with 10, one with 20, and one with 50 periods, which I believe are the periods of the moving averages too. And the thickest one, the 50 period RSI, we see that is the thickest one and doesn't oscillate that much because it needs 50 candles to come up with a value. And usually by the time 50 candles opened and closed, the market may end up being pretty close to where it was before. And the longer the RSI period is, we see the less amplitude we can expect it from this indicator to plot on our chart. On the other hand, when the RSI is very short, when it is a 10, we see often it gets overbought or oversold, and we may have confirmation sooner than when it is on 20 periods, for example, or the 14 periods, which is the standard value. So how we pick our indicators, how we adjust them, is practically mitigating this noise and lag, because we are making the indicators be more reactive, and by that we are doing something that might work against us, because reactivity, more reactive indicator may be may provide a less stable signal. And on the other hand, when the indicators are less reactive, we tend to get more stable results. And this concludes practically the slide stack I prepared. And as you may remember, for example, if you attended other webinars with us, or you've watched some recordings, now is the moment when I am asking you if you please first participate in this little poll we have and are trying to gauge the interest and the reactions you might have to this kind of presentation. And in the meantime, while people are putting in their ratings, I'm also reminding you that if you have questions, you may want to write them in the chat window of the GoToWebinar application, and I'm happily answering them to the best of my abilities. If time permits it, we're already at 1 hour and 8 minutes, but we'll go a few minutes more to help you better understand maybe some aspects that were not properly addressed or sufficiently clearly explained, let's say. So please do ask questions. I will I believe there is enough time, there was enough time for the questions to come in. And I will close the poll. So let's see. Questions. Why length of ATR 10, not 14, or any other length? Is something Ed is asking, or was asking at a certain moment. Let's see together. Why ATR 10 and not 14? If anybody else may want to chip in, please write it and I'll read it. If not, I will try to get to the platform and we'll look at this together. Is that good enough for you? Why ATR 14, 10 and not 14? How do you want to approach this? Asking about ATR, I believe it was interested in the reversal to the mean system, generally speaking. For that, we get the Bollinger bands because that's what we used as an example. We put it to standard deviation and 20 periods back, right, on the chart. And on the bottom, we put an ATR. Let's put the standard one. And below it, another one, and we'll make this a 10. Let's see what are the differences. What can we notice, for example? The same Bollinger bands on the main chart, different ATRs down below. We see that the 14 periods ATR tends to be a little bit more sluggish, and the 10 periods ATR tends to be a little bit more, a bit faster. How is that? Because it only calculates the last 10, not the last 14 bars back. We see the 14 one has a spike here, when the 10 one has a spike earlier. Again here, we see the spike first on the 10 and then on the 14. And we know, if we look at the 10 periods ATR, we know sooner that a high point in the market is happening, and we also know sooner that already the volatility drops. And by the time the 14 periods ATR is signaling us something, we are already here on the 10. So we are already aware for maybe a couple of bars already that the market we are trading is decreasing in volatility, is becoming less volatile. Is that something worth knowing? Yes, if we intend to act on it. So that is why ATR period, like any other indicators period, is important to get what the market is doing now, because we are getting sooner information about what already happened. How much sooner? This much sooner. Let's look exactly at that example. Let's say we are in here. We see the spike on this candle. This was the highest point. Then on this candle, we already see that the market is becoming less volatile. What do we do here? When we are out of the Bollinger Band, we are already in a market that we see is becoming less volatile. Is this a good reversion to the mean entry point? Maybe. Do we know when this candle happens? No, we don't. Will we ever know? Never. We will never know what happens next. But this is the moment when we have sooner information about what already happened. Sooner than here. It may not count for much, but if we get the information on this candle, for example, and we wait for this candle to close and we enter here, we are already a bit too late. I guess that is satisfying enough. And if you have any other questions, please ask, don't be shy. We are a family here. And I'm happy to oblige. Marcos, Lynn, Kyriakos, Charles, Andre, come on. No questions at all. We know all we need to know. That's a good thing to be certain of. So, that being said, because you are not very eager to interact with me, I don't know if it's me, let's say it is me, I am telling you, I am very glad that you attended. The recording will also be available on our website, as you are already used to. Our Facebook group is open to any of our students to interact in between them and with our staff. Please don't be shy. There isn't such thing as a stupid questions. There are only shy people that don't write the right questions and don't look for the right answers. I see someone bite the bullet, so to speak, and Charles asked, are these the new avionics you referred to for paper plane? Yes, paper plane is the ongoing project in our, let's say, community. And as a community project, I tried to make it a community project by definition. In an attempt to make it a community project, I started and put in the paper plane what needed to be put in order to make it a functional expert advisor. And now it's in your hands, it's in our hands collectively. As you may be aware of, not you, Charles, but all of you that are seeing this, in the Facebook group, I asked for your opinions and feedback, and I am prepared to implement and talk about and discuss and present topics that interests you. But I have no way of knowing what is of interest to you if you don't come forward, you don't ask questions, you don't make posts, you don't participate in testing. Expert advisor, advisors in general, I can create on my own with what I know. The paper plane is a community project, so I need a community to work on that project. If you want it to fly only left, we can make it fly only left. If you want it to look at the weather, coming to the subject of this webinar, and if you want to put in it new avionics, now you know how. Tell me what you need to know about more, and me and other people will be there to help you, and together we may even code it. But don't expect for the other people to give you a project that is already done, tested, and you can just plug it in and make money with it. This is a collective effort, and by definition, the whole community is expected to participate. I could very well make this webinar a coding webinar, and then I would have put, let's say, three functions that are trying to gauge based on what we've discussed about for an hour. And so the market phases, for example, and you would have that way gotten a piece of code that may have worked or not. We know nothing about it because we didn't do it that way. Because my inquiry about who tested and who has proposals for the new webinar or implementation or future development practically met silence, I choose to go toward the more theoretical presentation, and that was the current one. What I had in mind and what I end up doing was based on the reaction I've got. Is not you, it's me, because I choose to listen to the community, and the way the community reacted to what I've put out there made me understand that maybe the community is not interested in the coding part, but it is more interested in the theoretical part that may also be used in discretionary trading. And that way, we've done this type of webinar, which was more theoretical than practical. If you want it to be more practical than theoretical, say so. But not during the webinar, before the webinar, because we need to prepare for the webinar, the right things to show you, and the right code to give you. And it's not to start a controversial discussion or a polemic. It's how things are And if I'm wrong, I apologize. Okay, someone asks, how would you plot support and resistance line onto a chart automatically to be able to identify breakouts? There are a number of ways we can plot support and resistance line. That basically support and resistance as notions in trading, if you want my input regarding the subject as a general matter, these two are notions interchangeable or not with supply and demand. That's to be discussed, and it may be the subject of another 1 hour or more webinar. So these notions, if you ask me, are implying a degree of subjectivity that is not very well fitted to algorithmic trading, which is more my scope of interest. And not because they don't work like most people say, for example. The people that cannot find the right tools to do the right type of marking their charts and find the right zones of support and resistance say usually the support and resistance doesn't work. The people that are making money using concepts that involve support and resistance will argue that they do work because they make money by doing so. But that, if it's probabilistically speaking, if it's 50-50, then it's nothing special, neither about the people that say they work, nor about the people that say they don't work. How do we plot them? Depends how we define them. Because let's look at the simplest way, as I know how to define and plot such levels. And I don't know if it will come to you as a revelation, or as something you may laugh about with your friends over a beer. But let's put a 15-minute chart, for example. And on this 15-minute chart from the venerable Bill Williams, let's look at fractals, if you know what those are. Do this show on the chart as something that may be construed as support and resistance? It's something already there. It's something already in the platform. It's something that defines how the market moves in an objective manner. We choose groups of no more, no less than 5 candles. And when one picks up its head, it becomes an up fractal. When one is the lowest of them 5, having 2 at the left and 2 at the right that have higher lows, it becomes a down fractal. Or the other way around. I'm not sure. Let's make them more visible. If you see them, I believe you can, because on my screen they appear big enough. What do we have here? Do you think we have enough time to react? Because that's also something we must consider. Why don't we have a fractal here yet? Because we don't know if this will be a bottom in a group of 5 candles. When will we know that? When we will have at least 1 completed candle on the right side, and to be sure, we need 2 candles on the right side. And by that time, the price may be here, based on the recent volatility, for example. So hindsight is 20/20, as always in trading. Oh, what if I would have entered here to enter here, you have to have the fractal here. But this one doesn't appear until this candle opens. And when this candle opens, even after this candle opens, this may disappear if the price moves up here. So a fractal will remain in place as a method of, let's say, primitive method of plotting support and resistance. A fractal will remain in place if on the left of it has two candles and at the right of it has other two candles that don't invalidate this level. And here we see two candles that don't have a lower low than this low. To the left, we see two candles that don't have a lower low than this low. And this is a swing point in the market. We may use lines, we may use zones. How should we use them programmatically? Maybe we don't really need to use them programmatically or program for them, because there are already very good indicators that are already doing that. For example, I am using regularly one indicator that many other people use. Why? Not necessarily because I couldn't program a better one, but if more people use this indicator, then I am interested in seeing what the other people are seeing, because I'm trading with them, not against them, if I want to do the same thing. And I'm looking, if I can remember, let's say on this indicator, I can plot another time frame, and I'm asking it to show me on my charts levels that come from higher time frames, for example. Is that good enough? Is that a daily support I can see from my paper airplane? From the distance, yes, it is. If I want support and resistance levels on another time frame, I just put here, let's say, 240, and I'm seeing the support and resistance level from the 4-hour chart on the 15-minute chart I am currently on. And I may trade in between those zones. How they are constructed? They are usually done by defining zones where the price did what? By definition, what is a support or resistance zone? Usually it is defined that like a zone where the price reversed, and that reversal usually takes the form of a big wick. And how big is a wick and how thick you want to draw the zone, that is up to you and how you define that zone. Because people like to use lines, others like to use zones or rectangles. You may want to put a line under this wick, or you may want to put a zone that is as big as the wick or as big as half the wick, for example. And then when you move on another time frame, you may see what? Information about what happened there. You may see a line or a zone. What's more useful? Some will say a zone is more useful. Others will say a line is more useful. Why? Because, and everybody has their own, have their own reasons. The new avionics, to come back to the question before, we'll get in the paper plane after you will decide what you want to put in the next paper plane. And we will keep in touch in the Facebook group, and on our website's form. To identify breakouts, we may as well use zones. We may, for example, a popular trading idea is breakout of the London Open, for example. On my server time, London opens at 10 o'clock each day, and 10 o'clock is somewhere here. Let's put a vertical line, and let's assume that 9:45 is the last candle before London Open. So London practically opened, crammed under this resistance zone up there. What happens next? Dropped from there. I was talking about the popular system, that is, for example, Tokyo Open, somewhere around here, and we define a range that may be from the Tokyo Open till the London Open, and in between the lowest point during the Tokyo session and the highest point of the Tokyo session. And now when the price moves out of this range, we may have a breakout. If we define the breakout time based as a range based on the time parameter, let's say London doesn't open there but here, then we may read the highest high and the lowest low in a certain period of time in between a start time and an end time. And once the price moves one of the boundary, so the price is above the highest high or below the lowest low, we enter either with a pending order or at market, and we move for what we determine by backtesting that is more likely to happen statistically. In this case, we see that today we didn't have much of a breakout because maybe the market was already too extended and nobody wanted to get in this kind of move under that kind of resistance. And more traders were expecting to see what happens than willing to participate. In an EA, this is how we do it. If you want something like this in our paper plane, we can make a time filter, for example, for it. We can make it trade in between two or more hours. We can define different sessions. We may want, for example, make it look at a range like this if we find an edge or we want to explore that zone and approach this type of trading like a simple system does, for example, in one of our courses. And I see it still used after such a long time by many people. So what will happen next? Whatever you want. Speak to us, talk to us, ask us questions. We will try to answer them to the best of our abilities. And that being said, these are your opinions about this webinar. I thank you all for coming and participating. I invite you to contribute in our community, whether that will be the Facebook group or the forum on our webpage, which is absolutely free, by the way. You don't even need a membership to do that. So we may invite friends to that forum and collaborate with them there. We wait for your suggestions. We appreciate your support. We thank you very much again, and we invite you to our future events, and trade well, my friends.